Good morning. My name's Jim Walker. I'm the pastor of Revival from Down Under in the eastern suburbs of Melbourne in Australia. This morning, I'm going to speak on a topic which I think is probably not understood correctly by many Christians. And that topic is tithing. And when people preach on tithing, people think, oh, it's after money, oh, whatever. We need to understand that it's the Word of God. Tithing is God's Word. And if we're not tithing according to what the Word of God says, we are robbing God. And so I think one of the biggest problems in the church, one of the biggest problems in the church is people not tithing. They reckon there would be maybe somewhere between 10 and 15% of Christians tithe. And so that's why the church can't do what it's got to do, because the people are not doing what they're supposed to do. The tithe is for the ministry to live off, and that's not just that's not just the senior ministry, but any other ministries that he may feel in God to appoint must also be paid from the tithe. The church also takes up offerings, and I think probably many churches mix the two together. And if we study Scripture, we find that God is not into mixture. And the tithes and the offerings should never be mixed, because the tithe is for the ministry and the offering is for church expenses. Out of the offering and the church expenses are paid electricity bills, musical instruments, whatever cost may arise within the church is paid by the offering. If I had a church secretary, then she also would be paid out of the offering, not out of the tithe, because she's not ministry. Okay? She would be paid out of the offering. Any church expenses, out of the offering. But the tithe is given by God. The tithe is given by God to the ministries to live off. Now, people may, maybe, there may be several reasons why people don't tithe. Maybe they think they don't have enough to live off if they tithe. And maybe they just don't want to do it. Maybe the money means more to them than being obedient to God. There could be several reasons. It could be lack of understanding. And I'm hoping that it's the last one, that it's lack of understanding. And so once we have understanding that tithing is for the church today, and that for all Christians must tithe, once we get full understanding of this, if we have not been tithing, we need to repent and begin to tithe. And that's, and it's finished. God just wipes your slate clean. We will find also as we do this study that because people don't tithe, he says there is no meat in my house. That is that the person that he's got is not tithe, not the rest of the people. Because this is the house of God collectively, but I am also the house of God individually. And so if I am not tithing personally, there'll be no meat in this house. And that means God will not give me understanding of his word. I will not be getting the understanding of somebody that could be sat at the side of me who's tithing. They gain all the revelation and I'm not. And it's because we're not tithing. Amen. So I'm going to begin. I've called this teaching, Are Christians Required to Tithe? Are Christians required to tithe? Well, my answer to that is yes, we are. So we're going to begin in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and in verse 15. 2 Timothy 2. Now, if you listen to any of my teachings or you read any of my teachings, this is a scripture that I always use. This one and 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. The reason I use them is because they are keys. They are keys to understanding God's word. They are keys. So in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, we are told by the Apostle Paul to study, to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. I would possibly think that maybe even many pastors have not rightly divided the word of truth concerning tithing. They may tithe, but they don't understand why they're really tithing. They haven't got the full revelation of it. They tithe because they've been told to tithe, but themselves, they don't really know why. And so today, I'm going to give us, to the best of my ability and with God's help, I'm going to give us the understanding of what tithing is scripturally and how we should tithe, when we should tithe. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So, for scripture to be rightly divided, this studying must be done from all scripture, because of what the Apostle Paul tells us in 2 Timothy 3 verse 16, where he says all scriptures come by the inspiration of God, and it is profitable for doctrine, that is teaching, etc., etc. Amen. In Romans 15:4, the Apostle Paul tells us that all things that are let's read it. Romans 15 and verse 4. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning. Hallelujah. Whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning. Now, at this present time that Paul is writing this letter, the New Testament hadn't been compiled. It actually didn't get, I believe, maybe for 350 years or so after Paul had died. All the letters were put together and the new that Paul, Peter and John wrote, and the New Testament was compiled. So Paul here is saying the things that were written aforetime is obviously Old Testament scripture. And all the writers of the New Testament all wrote their letters from what they received of the revelation they got from Old Testament scripture. Amen. So that if they needed to do it, we need to do it. Also, we're told by Jesus in Matthew 4 and verse 4, he says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that has proceeded from the mouth of God. By how many words? Every word. And this is every word that has proceeded from the mouth of God. And that is from Genesis chapter 1 And the first word in Genesis chapter 1 verse 1 is in. And the last word in Revelation 22 is amen. So every word of God is contained between these two words. In and amen. So be it. Amen. Glory to God. And we are also required to live by every word. The word of God gives life to those who have ears to hear. Amen. If we study 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, in these verses, from verse 44 through 48, the Apostle Paul reveals to us a principle of God that is first the natural, then afterwards that which is spiritual. I'll read it. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. Do you know, we were talking about the resurrection before, and some have even wrongly divided the word on the resurrection. Do you know, some are waiting for the resurrection to occur. But yet the scripture clearly tells us, and I've got a couple of scriptures, one of them I'll read in a minute. But this says, it is sown a natural body. And before we were born again, we were the natural. But when we give our life to Jesus, it says we are raised a spiritual body. And a raising is a resurrection. Because the scripture says, we were dead in trespasses and sin, but now we are alive. So a resurrection has occurred. Amen? So the resurrection is not to come. The resurrection, the only resurrection that has got to come is the resurrection of the ungodly. That's the only resurrection that's got to yet occur. The resurrection of the just is happening from the time of Jesus to the time of Christ's return. People are being resurrected spiritually. It's a spiritual resurrection, not a natural one. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. So here, it then says, and so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul, and the last Adam was made a quickening spirit, or a life-giving spirit. Did you know there were two Adams? And so, the first Adam, when we read it, if you went back into Genesis, you find that God made Adam from the dirt, from the dust of the ground, the clay. All right? And so, it says, as it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. Howbeit, that which was not first, which is spiritual, but that which is natural. And afterwards, that which is spiritual. So the first Adam is natural. The second Adam is spiritual. The first man is of the earth, earthy, natural. The second man is the Lord from heaven. And anything from heaven or connected to heaven is spiritual. Amen. As is the earthy, such are they also that are earthy. And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. So that the heavenly are the spiritual ones. They are that which are spiritual. Hallelujah. So when we follow this pattern or this uh, what Paul has showed us here, this principle of God, when we follow this, we find it actually goes from Genesis to Revelation. It is used by God throughout all Scripture, from Genesis to Revelation. And we also find that Jesus himself used this principle when teaching in parables. And a parable is the use of natural things to represent something else. In this case, it's something natural to represent that which is spiritual. And we find that in the parable of the sower and the seed, when Jesus said, he speaks the parable in the natural, and then he gives the understanding of the parable in the spiritual. And he said, those who have ears to hear, let them hear what I have just said. And we know, he said, it's given to you to know, to his disciples. But no, it's not given to everybody. It's only given to them that have ears to hear. We find as we study this parable, we find that the seed speaks of and symbolizes the word of God. The ground in which the seed is sown speaks of and symbolizes the heart of man. And the conditions, the hard, stony, thorny, 30 and 60 grounds are conditions within the heart that prevent the seed from producing any fruit or from producing the fruit that is required by God, and that is 100. We heard at the communion table, Mark spoke on, mentioned John 15, I am the vine, you are the branches. Any branch in me that bears not fruit is cut off and thrown into the fire. But any branch that produces fruit is pruned to produce more fruit. But the Father seeks much fruit. And much fruit is 100. Amen? Glory to God. The fruit produced can only be produced by having full understanding of the Word of God. Full understanding of the Word of God. Being preached from all Scripture, not just what we think may apply. Hallelujah. Because many are not used in God's Scripture. Glory to God. If we follow this principle and we go back into the book of Genesis, we find that in the book of Genesis that Abraham is promised two seeds by God. He's promised two seeds by God. And so, following the principle of first the natural, the first seed promise would be, obviously, is natural seed. And the second seed would be the spiritual seed. And so if we go over into Genesis chapter 13, Genesis 13, this is the first seed promised. So this is speaking about Abraham's natural seed. Genesis 13, verse 16. Genesis 13 and verse 16. He says, and I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth. So there's your connection. I will make thy, anything that is of the dust of the earth is natural. That's what we just read. I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then so shall your seed be also numbered. And this is first. So it's dust, it's first, it's natural seed. If we go over into Genesis 15, verse 5, and he said, and he brought him forth abroad, and he said, look now towards heaven, and tell the stars if you be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall your seed be. So this is the second seed promised. This is heavenly seed. stars as of heaven. So this is his spiritual seed being promised. All right? So these two seeds, now you listen to this to get hold of this. These two seeds, the natural and the spiritual, represent natural Israel and spiritual Israel. They are the two promised seeds. We need to understand that. Very, very clearly. Are the two Israels mentioned in the New Testament? Yes, there are. And so, if we go into Romans and chapter 9, Romans 9, and in verse 6, it says, not as though the word of God has taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are of Israel, two Israels. They are not all Israel which are of Israel. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall your seed be called. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, natural Israel, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise, that is spiritual Israel, are counted for the seed. Hallelujah. Two Israels promised to Abraham that he would have two, there would be two seeds. If we go over into 1 Corinthians 10, and in verse 18, 1 Corinthians 10, and in verse 18, Paul says, behold, Israel after the flesh. And Israel after the flesh is natural Israel. Israel after the flesh is natural. We are Israel after the Spirit. We're not Israel after the flesh. We are Israel after the Spirit. Amen? You got that? Glory to God. We also see, if we go over into Romans 2, now what I'm doing here is setting a foundation, a basis for the proof that tithing is for today. Because if we understand first the natural, then the spiritual, then we will realize that what the natural did is also required of the spiritual. Everything they did is a foreshadowing, is a type of God's requirement of the true Israel of the church. Amen? And we'll see that as we're going along. Romans chapter 2 and verse 28, it says, for he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God. So here now we have two Jews. The natural Jew is circumcised in the outward. The spiritual Jew is circumcised in his heart. And that which circumcises is the word of God. It's the flesh being circumcised, but it's the word of God that does the circumcising. And it's symbolised by the pruning of the branches in John 15. Could you prune a branch with a sharp knife? And the sharp knife or the sharp sword is the word of God. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12. The word of God is like a sharp two-edged sword. And it's working on us all the time. It's working on us all. And it's cutting and cutting all the time. Sometimes we feel it, don't we? Hallelujah. But it's because he knows what he's doing. You know, the sword in the hands of a A surgeon, and he is the surgeon. He is the surgeon of surgeons. He knows what he's doing. He doesn't make any mistakes. He only cuts out that which is needed to be cut out. Amen? Glory to God. He's an expert at doing it. He's done that many. He's done a few now. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. He's still working on me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, again, following this principle, I'm not going to talk about there is also a natural Jerusalem spoken of in the scriptures, and scripture also tells us there's a spiritual Jerusalem. So that's also in scripture. But also there is a natural priesthood and there is a spiritual priesthood. When we study Exodus 19, we find that God called all Israel to be a kingdom of priests unto God. But through their unbelief, only the tribe of Levi became the priesthood. The call was to all Israel, but they didn't make it because of disobedience to his word. Only Levi did. All right? But that call, what is on God's heart has never changed. God still desires a kingdom of priests. And we find in the New Testament that God is doing the work in his people to be a kingdom of priests, not just one tribe. Amen? And we find this in 1 Peter. If we go into 1 Peter, 1 Peter chapter 2. If you actually studied Exodus 19, I think it's about verse 5 and 6, and it says, "You shall be a kingdom of priests unto me, a holy nation, a spiritual, acceptable to God." Well, he says it all here. Here in verse 5, it says, "You also." Who's he speaking to? Whoever's reading it. Are you reading it? If you're a reader, he's speaking to you.
That's right.
Amen? And so he's saying, "You also, as lively stones, are built up a what? A spiritual house. A what? A holy priesthood. To offer up spiritual sacrifices, not natural sacrifices, spiritual sacrifices, acceptable to God by Jesus Christ." Everything we do, if it's in God's will, is acceptable to God through Christ who saved us. Amen? Then if we go down into verse 9, he said, "But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood." So we're not just a priesthood, we are a royal priesthood. We are a holy nation. Spiritual Israel is a holy nation. That you should, a peculiar people. Hallelujah, etc. Amen? And so, first the natural, and then the spiritual. A royal priesthood is a priesthood of kings. King priests. You know, David fulfilled this. David was a king priest. He offered sacrifices. He was the king and he offered sacrifices. So he is a type of the king priest. And we find that with David is a wonderful type of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we study him. Amen. A wonderful type of the Lord Jesus. If we go over into Revelation chapter 1, this is why what we're doing this morning, we are studying so that we can be approved of God. Studying, rightly dividing the word, so God can approve us, so we can get it right. Hallelujah. In Revelation chapter 1 and in verse 6 it says, and he what? He has made us kingdom priests. When is that? Now. He has made us kingdom priests unto our God. If you go over into chapter 5 and verse 10, and he has made us unto our God kingdom priests. Amen? We are now kings and priests now. But how many people really know it?
Not many.
And that's why we're not doing it right. That's why we're not doing it right. Because we don't know. And the reason we don't know is because the people teaching us don't know. They haven't got the revelation of it. And it's as simple as that. But when they get the revelation, you know, they'll start doing it right. And it's coming. God's going to make a way. This priesthood, this royal priesthood, if we studied the book of Hebrews, is after the order of Melchizedek, not after the order of Aaron and the Levitical. And so we need to study the book of Hebrews, and we're just going to look at one or two verses in Hebrews. So in Hebrews chapter 6, there are more before this, but this is what it says in Hebrews 6 verse 20, where the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus Christ made a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. So Jesus is the high priest of the order of Melchizedek. And we are priests in that order. We're not in the Aaronic order, because the Aaronic order is finished. It's ceased. It's been changed. Amen? It's finished. It is ceased. So, if we now read Hebrews 7, from verse 10. Speaking of tithing, verse 9, and as I may say, Levi also, who received tithe, paid tithe in Abraham. He paid tithe in Abraham because tithing was not established by the law. Tithing was established by Abraham. So Levi paid tithe in his father, because Abraham is the father of all who believe, and they that believe should be tithing like he did, and to the person that he tithed to. Hallelujah. Glory to God. For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. If therefore perfection, isn't it marvellous how they connect tithing with perfection? Because that's what they're doing here. If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should arise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron? So you may have been questioning me in your heart before, why is he calling it the order of Aaron when it was the Levitical priesthood? Because that's what Paul calls it, the order of Aaron. So it was the order of Aaron. The new priesthood is the order of Melchizedek. Do you know why? Because when we study scripture, we find that God is a God of order and pattern. When he built the tabernacle of Moses, Moses was told to build it according to the pattern and then place everything in order. God is a God of pattern and a God of order. Amen. It then says in verse 12, for the priesthood being what? Changed. The priesthood being changed. Now, do you think you could tell me where the priesthood was changed? Probably not. Do you think you could? Jesus' baptism. When Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist. Why? Well, I'm going to tell you. Because a lot don't even know this, that John the Baptist was the high priest. He was the rightful high priest at the time of Jesus' water baptism, not Caiaphas. Caiaphas was appointed by the Romans to be the man. The rightful high priest was John the Baptist. How can I prove that? By studying the word. If we look in the book of Luke and chapter 1, we look in Luke chapter 1, it speaks of the father of John the Baptist, and his name is Zechariah. Zechariah is the father of John the Baptist. And it says in Luke 1 and verse 5, there was in the days of Herod the king of Judea a certain priest named Zacharias of the course of Abia, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Now, they chose a wife within the tribe. That they had to do. It was under the law. Aaron had to choose a wife from amongst his own brethren. And this continued throughout the generations. And so here we, this is what we, so here we find not only is Zacharias from the seed of Aaron, so was his wife. Hallelujah. Amen. They were both righteous before God, walking all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. They had no child because that Elizabeth was barren, and they both were now well stricken in years. And it came to pass that while he, that is Zacharias, while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. So his responsibility, his duty was to burn incense. Amen? Amen? Now if we go over into Exodus chapter 30, you'll find it says this, Exodus 30. This is just proving that Zechariah is the high priest. Chapter 30, verse 7. And Aaron shall burn thereon sweet incense every morning. This is the lot of the high priest, to burn incense. Nobody else can do it. No other priest is allowed. Only the high priest is allowed to burn incense on the altar. So what Zechariah was doing in his ministry as high priest. And the high priesthood was passed from father to son. It was passed from father to son. So the son of Zechariah was John the Baptist. So John the Baptist was the rightful high priest at the time of Jesus. And that's why he said, that's why Jesus said, it behoves you to do what is right. And at that time, when John baptized Jesus, the priesthood changed. It went from the Levitical to the Melchizedek. How the new order came in. Hallelujah. Amen. This is awesome stuff. I'd give myself a pat on the back if my arms were long enough, but they're not long enough. Hallelujah. Glory. It's awesome preaching. We need to understand this. Glory to God. If we go into 1 Corinthians 10, 1 Corinthians 10, now 1 Corinthians 10 verse 1 through 11 is what Paul's talking about. But I just want to pick up on a couple of the verses. You need to read all the chapter, all the verses to understand what Paul's really saying. But firstly, he says, verse 1, moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant. Who's he talking to? Talking to whoever's reading. If you're reading that, he's talking. Moreover, Carolyn. Moreover, Carolyn, I don't want you to be ignorant. That's what he's saying. So I want, and if you're not ignorant, you have understanding. So I want you to understand what I'm about to say. All right? And then he goes on, he says all these. Then he says in verse 6, now these things were our examples. Then you go down into verse 11 and it says, now all these things happened unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world have come. So they're not written for that generation. They're written for this generation, upon whom the ends of the world have come. So we need to have understanding of what Paul is saying, because he's not really writing to the, although he wrote to the Corinthian church, it was for our benefit in the days we now live. The word admonition means warning. That's what it means, warning. The word ensamples and the word examples comes from the Greek word tupos. And we need to understand what that word tupos is saying. It means a stamp, a print. This is what it means in, if you study the word in the Greek, a stamp, a print, a die has been cast, a type, a figure, a pattern, etc., etc. A shadow. That's what it means. So everything that happened to them was a shadow, a print, a figure, a type for the church today, for us to learn from, that we don't make the mistakes that they made. Because otherwise God will not be happy with us either. And that's the warning. That is the admonition. That is the warning. Don't do what they did. Why? Because I am the Lord. I do not change. Glory to God. Now here, I have a little stamp. Little stamp. Now what I'm going to do is, I've got a piece of paper here. And I've just stamped that. See that? I've just stamped that. See? Every time I stamp it, it comes out the same. Doesn't change. Every time I stamp it, it comes out the same. Now, can you see what that says? Can you zoom in on that? Just to see what that says? Can you pick it up? It says, not negotiable. That's what it says. It says, not negotiable. Now, that's only a print from that. That is not that. This is what casts the print. This is what casts the shadow. And every time, it's the same. And God's word is not negotiable. God's word is not negotiable. What he said, he will do, and it shall not return to him void. It shall accomplish that which he pleases, and it shall prosper in the thing that he has sent it to do. If we have ears to hear and do what we hear. If we're not doing what we hear, we are foolish. We're like the wise man that built his house upon the rock, and his house stood, and the foolish man built his house up on the sand, and it fell. Both heard, one did, one didn't do. Amen? Glory to God. Hallelujah. We are not to be ignorant. We are not to be ignorant. All things happen to them for our example, or our type, or a pattern, or a figure. All things, including tithes and offerings. Including tithes. That's why God said in Malachi 3, you've robbed me in tithes and offerings. Because everything happened to them for our example. We'll look at that shortly. Amen. I said before, tithing was established by Abraham, not by the law. It was 400 years before the law. And so, if we go back into Genesis chapter 14, we find where it was established by Abraham. Genesis 14. Here in Genesis 14, it said in verse 18, and Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth, what did he bring forth? Bread and wine. Do you know what bread and wine are? They are the symbols of communion in the New Testament. So we see what happens here connected to the New Testament. This is concerning New Testament communion. And tithes are given with the taking of communion in the New Testament. Hallelujah. This Melchizedek was the priest of the Most High God. Now some have put him as a natural priest on earth because they have no understanding of who this guy Melchizedek is. They have no understanding whatsoever. They just think he was a man appointed to be a priest of God. How wrong can you be? Then said in verse 20, and blessed be the Most High God, which to deliver your enemies into your hand. And he gave him tithes of all he had. So here tithing is established by Father Abraham, who is the father of all who believe. Amen? Now, what we need to do now is prove who is he tithing to? Who is this Melchizedek? Who is it? Who is he? Do you know? Let's go to Hebrews chapter 7. Hebrews 7. And this, if you have ears to hear this morning, this is very, very clear who this Melchizedek is. Verse 1, for this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, that is a tithe mentioned in the New Testament, a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation, king of righteousness, and after that, king of Salem, which is king of peace. Tell me, who is the king of righteousness? Who is the king of peace? Jesus is. Jesus is. Who is the King of Jerusalem? On which Jerusalem? Heavenly Jerusalem. Jesus is. He is King of Jerusalem. He is King of peace. He is King, King, King of righteousness. Hallelujah. And Abraham tithed to him. Let's carry on. He, this Melchizedek, he is without father. He is without mother. That means he wasn't born. He has no descent. He has no beginning of days, nor end of life. So who is he? He is God. He is one of the Godhead. But which one? Which one? In John chapter 1, it tells us in verse 1 and 2, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. All right? Before the foundation of the earth, and before Jesus was born, it was the Word of God. It was only became Jesus when he was born and named. Amen? Before that, it was the Word of God. So who visited Abraham? The Word of God. As the priest in the Godhead. He is the priest in the Godhead. Do you know every family in the Old Testament had a priest in the family? Job? What did Job do? He offered sacrifices for his family, so he's a priest. Job, a priest, offering sacrifices. Abraham acted as a priest, offered sacrifices. Noah offered sacrifices. Oh, it's a type of priesthood. Hallelujah. And so in the family of God, the priest is Jesus Christ, was the Word of God, who then became Jesus, who became the priest after the same order. He's the one that has the rightful place of being who he is. Hallelujah. Amen. Have you got that? It is so simple. Glory to God. Well, to me it is. Hallelujah. Amen. If we go into Hebrews chapter 8, and we'll read from verse 1. Now, of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such a high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. His name is Jesus. A minister of the true sanctuary. He's a minister. He's a priest of the true sanctuary, which is in heaven, and that Moses' sanctuary is a copy of, a pattern of. And this sanctuary in heaven has always existed. Always existed. Hallelujah. And Melchizedek, because it's an eternal priesthood, has always been priest in that temple in heaven. Glory to God. Hallelujah. A minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched, not man. Hallelujah. Verse 5. Who serve all the priesthood, who serve unto the example and shadow of what is happening in the heavenlies. And what is happening in the heavenlies is spiritual. Where did Mark say we were supposed to be seated? In heavenly places. We are seated in heavenly places. We're seated with him, functioning as priests with him. We're doing everything. If we're hearing right. Hallelujah. Who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle, see, he said, that you make all things according to the pattern. Everything was made according to the pattern because it represented that which is heavenly. And you know, there is a transition. You know, there's a transition from the tabernacle of Moses to the Temple of Solomon, and from the Temple of Solomon to the church. That is the transition. Because we are now, the scripture says, we are now the temple of the living God. There has been a transition. We are the house of God. Hallelujah. And so everything that was foreshadowed is required in the true temple, the church. Are you hearing this? Are you hear? This is wonderful stuff if we get hold of it. If you get hold of this and you hear this and you've not been tithing, you'll start tithing. And do you know, the church will benefit by it. Glory to God. And guess what? So will you. Because God cannot. Once you start, God rebukes the devourer of your life. Hallelujah. He has no access to you. To your fat. You know, if you're not tithing, the scripture says it's like putting your money in a bag that's got holes in. You just putting your money in the bag, and you know what happens if you put the money in a bag with holes? It falls through, and you don't know because you know you're walking along. You don't know it's coming out, and you know who's coming behind you picking it up? The devil. And he uses it for his purposes instead of the purposes of God. He raises up false ministries and promises them all kinds of things. Hallelujah. Has he got a right to do that? Well, he actually has at this time. He offered Jesus, but Jesus, you know, when Jesus was in the wilderness, he offered, if you bow to me, if you do, I'll give you this, I'll give you this, I'll give you this. And all he can do is, he always uses deception. Because scripture says he's the prince of this world. He is the prince of this world. Jesus is not the prince of this world. He's the prince of heaven. And that's where we're supposed to be. And that's where we are going. Hallelujah. All things down here are under his feet. Hallelujah. Heaven is my throne. The earth is my footstool. He sat on the throne and everything is only under his feet, including the devil. Hallelujah. Amen. Not negotiable. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So, everything happened to them. So what we need to do is go and find how they were told to tithe. And who they were tithe to tithe to. All tithing is to God, but God allows the use of it by the ministries. Well, he doesn't need it, you know. It's just the pattern. All right? So if we go back into Numbers 18. In verse 21 it says, "Behold, I have given the children of Levi all the tenth of Israel." This is the Levites, the ministries. I have given Levi, the ministries, speaks of the ministries, the tenth from Israel. Everything happened to them. This is a foreshadowing. Amen? Got that? Glory to God. And it's given to them as an inheritance. The tithe is given as an inheritance because they had no inheritance in Israel. They didn't have their own cities and that, like the rest of the tribes were given. Then it says in verse 24 through 26, "But the tithe of the children of Israel, which they offered as they offer it as a heave offering." So the tithe is offered as a heave offering to God. I don't fully understand what that is, but just something God said. All right. It's offered as a heave offering to God. "I have given to the Levites to inherit. Therefore I have said unto them among the children of Israel, they shall have no inheritance. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, Thus speak unto the Levites, and say unto them, When ye take of the children of Israel the tithe, which I have given to you from them for your inheritance, then you shall offer up a heave offering of it to the Lord, even a tenth of the tithe." That means they were tithed too, and then they, the ministry, had to tithe from what they were given as a tithe. They had to tithe that, a tenth of that, to the Lord. That means when you tithe to me, I have to tithe a tenth of what you give me and give it to the Lord. Hallelujah. But he can't receive it. And I can't tithe to myself. So I must tithe out of my church. My tithe has got to go to another ministry out of my church. Preferably a senior minister. And you tithe to him because he is likened to the high priest, the senior ministry in the church. Amen. If you read verse 28, thus also you shall offer a heave offering unto the Lord of all your tithes which you receive of the children of Israel, and you shall give thereof the Lord's heave offering to Aaron the priest. So the ministry is tied to the high priest. And so when I give my tithe, I'm giving it to my high priest. And my high priest is Melchizedek. Hallelujah. Amen. And when I tithe out of the church, he sees what I'm doing and he counts it to me as righteousness. Amen. Amen. Glory. Isn't God good? Are we getting understanding this morning? Hallelujah. Don't forget, all things happen to them. In Proverbs chapter 3, and in verse 9, Proverbs 3 verse 9 through 10, it says, "Honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of all your increase." How much? All your increase. So if we do what God requires, he will do the next verse to you. So shall your barns be filled with plenty, your presses shall burst out with new wine, etc. New wine speaks of the life of God. Hallelujah. How can you put old wine in a new vessel? Doesn't work. So it speaks of the life. Now, who's he speaking to? Well, just if you read verse 1, it says, my son, forget not my law, but let your heart keep my commandments. So, honour the Lord with your substance, and with the first fruits of your increase. So shall your barns be. All right, so it's speaking to you, my son, the one that's reading it. Hallelujah. Amen. If you're short in your barns, it's because you're not doing it right. God has to, if you are honouring the Lord according to his word, he has to honour you by doing what he said. Hallelujah. Hallelujah! Don't forget, we started off in study to show yourselves approved. And that studying was to be from all scripture so that it can be profitable to you. Now, it can only be profitable to you if you're hearing it, if you do it, and then it will cause you to profit. Hallelujah. And I can tell you, there's no better prophet than John the Baptist. No, it's not. No. There's no better way for you to profit than for you to be hearing the word. Money just comes and goes. But hearing the word gives you life eternal. That's the best way you can profit. Amen. Glory to God. Finally, almost finally, yes, finally, in Malachi chapter 3, and in verse 6 it says, I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob, you are not consumed. That's because he's a righteous God, he's a loving God. He could have consumed them over and over and over again, and he didn't. And he didn't. Then says in verse 7, even from the days of your fathers, you've gone away from my ordinances. He could have consumed them because they went away from his ordinances. And one of the ordinances was tithing. An ordinance is an order. Hallelujah. It's a law. Even from the days of your father, you've gone away from my ordinances. You have not kept them. Return unto me, and I will return unto you, said the Lord of hosts. But you said, wherein shall we return? And then he says, will a man rob God? They hadn't been tithing. And by not tithing, they were robbing God. But you said, where have you robbed you? And he said, in tithe, not just in tithe, but in tithes and offerings. In Exodus 35, it says, bring me an offering. And we are to bring an offering to God every time we come to church. Every time you come, they came before God, they were to bring an offering. Otherwise, we're robbing him. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring you all the tithe into the storehouse. Now, we just read in Proverbs that your barn's be full. Hallelujah. So if the tithes come to the storehouse, and the storehouse is where the grain is given out from, and the grain speaks of the Word of God, bring me the tithes to where the grain is given out from, so that you can be blessed. Bring you all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. He wants there to be meat in your house. He wants you to have understanding. He wants you to have revelation of his word. But if you're not tithing, he can't give you revelation. He can't give you understanding, because you're not in obedience to his word. And you're just like them. If you're not tithing, you're not in obedience, and you're just like them. Hallelujah. I'm speaking to you people on the internet as well. YouTube, is it? That's what it's called, and YouTube. Have you got ears to hear what's being said this morning? He then says, if you bring me the tithe, will I not open to you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it? And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground. This is the ground. We read earlier, the pruning comes along so that the branch produces more fruit. The devil wants to destroy what God is trying to produce. And lack of tithing destroys the fruit you're producing. Hallelujah. Destroy the fruit of your ground, neither shall your vine cast her fruit. Do you know, Mark said that the fruit should remain on the branch. If we're not tithing, the branch, you cast the fruit, and you become unfruitful. That's scary stuff. And all nations shall call you blessed, and you shall be a delightsome land, says the Lord. You shall be, because they that do it right are his delight. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, the thing is, we've heard this teaching this morning. We know it's right. We know it's the will of God. And if you were ignorant before you came in, you are now no longer ignorant. So, lack of ignorance, you can't say, I didn't know. You're no longer ignorant. All we need to do is repent and start doing what we have heard this morning. And everybody said, oh, yeah. Tithing is given at communion. Now, one of the problems I see in the church today is the pastors take the tithe, but are not providing communion on a weekly basis. Scripture says on the first day of the week, they ate bread. So communion is taken on the first day of the week. In 1 Corinthians 11, it says, as often as you eat and drink. So it can actually be taken more often than just one day a week. But the minimum is the pattern. And the pattern is on the first day of the week. And so as we provide communion, that's when the tithe is given. So the tithe box should be on the communion table. As you take communion, you should put your tithe in and give it to God. Amen? Amen? Got that? God bless you. Love you. May the Lord keep you. May his light shine upon you. And may he give you rest. Amen.